So the first two lists are resentments and fears. Resentments are based in fear, but the second list is a list of fears, even though we had no resentment in connection with them. And it doesn't really tell you, you know, what to write. It's up to you. Whatever it is that you were afraid of is what you list on paper. But remember, this is not a search for morbid negativity. This is a search to, as it says in the third step, and I'll read it right from here, right from the third step. At once, followed by a strenuous effort to face and be rid of the things in ourselves which had been blocking us from doing God's will. The decision of the third step will have little permanent effect unless at once followed by a strenuous effort to face, write it down, and be rid, to apply the solution, of the things in ourselves which had been blocking us from doing God's will. Our liquor was but a symptom, so we had to get down to causes and conditions. Back to the fears list, we're going to find out how to be free of fears real quick. Didn't want to take up so much in the meeting, but that's why I didn't want to do all four lists this week, because I could talk about this for hours. Where was I? I was perhaps right about in the middle of page 68. Perhaps there is a better way. We think so. For we are now on a different basis, the basis of trusting and relying upon God. We trust infinite God rather than our finite selves. I know I read that before, but I'll read it again real quick. We are in the world to play the role He assigns, just to the extent that we do as we think He would have us, and humbly rely on Him, does He enable us to match calamity with serenity. We never apologize to anyone for depending upon our Creator. We can laugh at those who think spirituality the way of weakness. Paradoxically, it is the way of strength. The verdict of the ages is that faith means courage. All men of faith have courage. They trust their God. We never apologize for God. Instead, we let Him demonstrate through us what He can do. Now, this is one little sentence which I believe is the most important thing in my life as a recovering alcoholic. And I tell my sponsees, I say, this is going to be the most important thing in your life too. Because if fear is what makes me drink, then freedom from fear is probably the most important thing in my life, okay? We asked Him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what He would have us be. At once we commenced to outgrow fear. Now I can't tell you how many times I've read that, and it was the same as if I was reading something like this over here. They see significance everywhere. Our school would allow a man no flavor, or no flair, something like that. You know, something like that doesn't mean anything like what we just read. But this, to me, is the most important thing because it is the solution to fear. The spiritual solution to fear is to, number one, realize that all those fears are based in self. They are all self-centered fears. And how do we get rid of self? By thinking and doing things for others. If we're thinking about other people and doing things for other people, then we're not thinking about ourselves. And what happens is maybe the fears won't go away completely. Maybe the fears won't completely disappear and we'll never think about them again. Maybe they will. But what I can guarantee you is that the fears will come down to a level that will not require you to reach for a bottle of alcohol to quell them, to get rid of them. Okay? And what he's saying here, we asked Him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what He would have us be. And remember, I haven't really gone into that tonight, but the whole idea is, what is it that God wants you to do? He wants you to do things for other people. That's all there is to it. And I like to say, He can't just blink things like I Dream a Genie into people's lives. He can't just come around and pow, He's a burning bush and He does something for somebody. They'd be locking them people up left and right, okay? That's all there is to it. We have a certain realm of reality in which we live in, and how God does things for people is through other people. If God came to me in an AA meeting, I can tell you that He came to me from another person. And all these steps have been given to me from Bill Wilson and the First 100 that wrote this book, and the guy that sponsored me and taught it to me, and the guys that I've heard going through the steps at meetings or seminars or wherever it was. So, in a sense, God came to me, but He came to me through other people. You understand that? And that's basically how everything in your life is going to work. When you do things for your family, for your friends, for the people that are in your life, consider it to be actions that you're going to, it's sort of like God's doing it for them. You're no longer doing it as a selfish thing. You're sort of showing up for duty and doing what God wants you to do. We asked Him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what He would have us be, and at once we commenced to outgrow fear. So it's that simple. It really is. The whole program of Alcoholics Anonymous is that we face and be rid of the things that are blocking us from doing God's will, and then we try to go out and do God's will, and we are given the promises of the 10th step. And real quick, I'm going to go out there just for an instant. And the promises of the 9th step are good too, but the promises of the 10th step are real easy. It says, at the bottom of page 84, "And we have ceased fighting anything or anyone, even alcohol, for by this time sanity will have returned." What sanity are we talking about? We're not talking about loony bin insanity. We're talking about the alcoholic who reaches for that first drink and it's been beating you to death. It's been beating whoever it is to death for years, decades, whatever it's been, however long it's been, yet you continue to reach for that beer. That's what we're calling insane. It's absolutely insane to reach for that drink. And in the 10th step, it says to you, "For by this time sanity will have returned. We will seldom be interested in liquor. If tempted, we will recoil from it as if from a hot flame. We react sanely and normally, and we will find that this has happened automatically. We will see that our new attitude toward liquor has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. It just comes. That's the miracle of it. We're not fighting it. Neither are we avoiding temptation. We feel as though we've been placed in the position of neutrality, safe and protected. We have not even sworn off. Instead, the problem has been removed. It does not exist." And I can guarantee you, if you do what's outlined in these steps, it's going to happen for you too, because I am a real alcoholic, and it worked for me, and it continues to work for me. And I'm convinced that if I do this for the rest of my life, I can sit in an AA meeting and tell you people that you never have to feel that way again. For the rest of your life, you can stay sober. All you have to do is stay on this path toward God's will, and you will be given the immunity from alcohol. That first drink is all you're worried about. You're not worried about the second, the third, the 100th, 10 years down the road. It's that first one that you got to put God between you and that first drink and keep him there. And we got like 10 minutes if someone would like to share their experience with the fourth step or ask questions or whatever the case may be. Anybody else?
I'm an alcoholic from home from David Utah. And it's ironic that when you talk about the fourth step, you were reading something about after doing the third step, we jump into the fourth step, and that's where I met with my sponsor. You know, we were doing the third step, so now I got this sense of urgency, I'm ready, you know, to be rocking to this fourth dimension, and he just stopped calling me. You know, I called him for the last 2 weeks, and I'm like anxious to get rid of these fears and talk about my resentment, my anger, my sex issues, and he hasn't called me. And I'm like, I don't know. Ever since he stopped calling me, it's like I'm declining spiritually now, because I was like really hungry and stuff. And I, you know, when I first came to this program, it always questioned this fourth step, you know, and why is it like so important? You know, I feel like that I went out a couple of times because I was reluctant to that fourth step. And, you know, and I realize now that all those steps are important, don't get me wrong, but that's...